Aloha. Welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers, Politics in Hawaii series. I'm your host, Carl Campagna. In our country, in our state, we have a party system for our politics. And the two primary, I guess, strong parties that we have, and it seems to be only a two-party system, would be the Democrats and the Republicans. There are other parties, so it's not as, I guess digital is that. It's not one and zero only. There are other options, but the two strongest ones are Democrat and Republican. And some people think that's good, some people think that's bad. I think it's good to have a lot of viewpoints. So today we're going to talk about, what these parties are and how they work a little bit. But we're going to focus that question on the Democratic Party of Hawaii. And today our guest is Ms. Laura Nevitt, who is the new executive director of the Democratic Party of Hawaii. And we're going to hear a bit from her about what she's done, what her role is, and a little bit about what the party really function is and really what role the party plays. So this will probably be very similar from Democrat to Republican and other parties. There might be some variances, but that's what we're going to learn today. So thank you for joining us, and thank you, Laura, for joining us on the show.
Thank you for having me. It's great to be here.
Excellent. So First of all, welcome to Hawaii.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here. Can't believe I'm here most days, but in a good way. Very happy to be here.
Excellent. So how long have you been here now?
I arrived on February 7th. So Super Bowl Sunday, actually, is when I arrived. And have been kind of here, so that was, I think, 2 months now?
Yeah, about two months.
Two full months, yeah.
Yeah. And where'd you come from?
I came from Minnesota.
So wow, you came from snow.
I came from snow. Actually, the day I left, it was 20 degrees in Minnesota. So it was quite lovely to, after a long journey here, to arrive in a beautiful, sunny, tropical place. And I think it was probably about 75 degrees, 8 degrees when I... It couldn't have been better.
It's about normal. It's about 80 degrees, 80 to 84 degrees,
great.
And sunny most days.
I love it. I love it.
Excellent. So, okay, speaking about that, then let's talk about how, your journey. What has gotten you here at all? What have you been doing? Tell us about yourself and what has gotten you to this place.
A long journey, a good journey, though. 20 years I've been doing this work. Started when I moved to rural Wisconsin in 1995, sorry, and got involved with my local Democratic Party. I was doing an internship at a women's shelter, and my local county unit chair came and introduced himself, and we got chatting, and he was like, "Oh my God, you got to come and get involved." And I was like, "Okay." I had no idea what I was doing, and mostly just did it as a place to get engaged in my community, and that's kind of how I got started, and ended up getting involved in a gubernatorial race that year. And they then brought me on board because we did some local organizing, and then off I went, and haven't looked back. And I've gotten to go to a lot of really cool places and meet a lot of really amazing people, which is mostly what I remember, is the people and the stories that I get to learn in different places. So I've worked in Wisconsin and Minnesota and Michigan and Ohio and Iowa and Louisiana in Washington State and now Hawaii. And so I've gotten to be all over the place, and that's really what I enjoy. I like that. I like to hear people's stories and learn about them and learn about their communities and what they need and what they want and what they're trying to accomplish and help facilitate that. So
what would you say, looking at all of those different locations, what would you say some of the similarities are and some of the differences are? Is it an easy way to do an assessment?
It's kind of, I say they're the same, but yet different. It is kind of an interesting, just different flavors, right? It's basically what you learn and being around a lot of different communities is most everybody wants the same thing. They're trying to do the same things. They want to live in a good community or a better community or improve their community. They want good jobs so they can take care of their families and educate their kids. And do the things that make them happy and feel productive in their community.
They want access to healthcare. They want
all of that stuff.
Most
everybody does. How they go about it, the flavor is the cultural flavors of being, getting to spend time down in New Orleans, right, with Creole communities is different than spending time with nurses in Detroit. It's kind of as the same as when I lived in a rural community for 8 years. meeting with, talking with farmers and hunters is not the same as living in an urban setting when I lived in St. Paul, Minnesota, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, but that's the great, to me, the great journey and the great experience. And I really have been very privileged to be able to go and be in a lot of different places and do a lot of different things and meet, you know, I got to meet Max Cleland, who was a congressman or senator from Georgia who, you know, blew off three of his limbs in the Vietnam War. And I got to meet him through my county chairman, who turned out had been the man who had saved him on the tarmac in Vietnam, right?
Wow.
So those are amazing stories. I remember the farmer in La Crosse, Wisconsin, when I worked for Senator Cole, who used to come in every day and quiz me on milk prices and bean prices, right? And so having to learn why that was important to farmers.
Why that's relevant.
Why that is relevant to their life. To the retired Catholic priest who used to come in and talk to me about choice and education as someone who's very concerned. He considered himself a Democrat, but of course was anti-choice and for school vouchers. It was a really interesting, but to learn his story as a child who grew up in poverty, and what saved him was the being able to go to a Catholic, you know, school, right? And so that was what you understand. Yeah. It was being down in Louisiana and talking to small business solar energy people about energy in an oil state, right? That's, it's the stories, the members, when I worked at a union in Washington State, nurses all over the state, and hearing their stories about their biggest concern, which is patient care. Right, and what they were fighting for as a union member, and hospitals that are making profits off of their labor and trying to kick them to the curb, right? So all of those things, those are the things I take with me. And all of those values tie back to being a Democrat. I started as an activist in the Democratic Party. That's who I am.
Has all of these, or have all of these experiences grown your strength in the party, grown your position in the party?
Absolutely.
How has it affected? Has it just made it stronger?
It's just made it stronger.
More
because
deeply rooted?
Deeply rooted, because I hear those stories and those connect. Those are exactly the values that we as Democrats carry with us. And what we're fighting for are those workers and those farmers and those people living in poverty,
yeah,
and those nurses at those hospitals and the patients at those hospitals, right? That's who we fight for. And those are the policies we're trying to implement as,
yeah,
a Democratic Party.
And yet we have a disconnect right now.
We do.
Which not a lot of people fully understand,
mm-hmm,
and I think a lot of people are still trying to figure out,
right,
how to bridge that again. So,
and I think we bridge it by learning to tell our stories. What we've forgotten are,
yeah,
are the stories and the people that make us a Democratic Party and the values that brings along with it, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Everybody has their story about why they're a Democrat, right?
Yeah.
And that, but it's the value we have forgotten. We've gotten away from the value piece of it.
Yeah.
We've gotten too much into data points and talking points and facts and figures. And while that's important and that's good tools to have,
yeah,
to back up your story,
yeah,
first and foremost is to be able to tell your story about why you are a Democrat, what it means to you. And I think if we can teach our members and our folks to be out there doing that and talking to their neighbors and their family members,
yeah,
and their coworkers, and that's where we will then bring it back to where we need to be. I think we've lost that ability, we've,
yeah,
lost that skill, and we just, but it's a skill that we can teach people to do.
So it's a skill. We're not connecting face,
right,
to face the way,
right,
we used to.
Well, it's also people have gotten afraid of having political conversations with people they know, right?
Yeah.
And so I always was amazed being out doing a lot of campaign work. People coming, volunteers coming in a door knock, and they'd be like, but I don't want to go door knock in my neighborhood. And it was just like, but that's, people know you there,
people
and that's
that,
where you're,
yeah,
more influential. But of course, that was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And we saw, seen over the last couple years, it's the having the uncomfortable conversation about race or sexism or whatever it is, right?
Yeah.
Choice, whatever you want to be talking about. That's and because people don't know how, we've lost how we do that, and so, yeah, I really see. While I absolutely wish we were not where we are today nationally, and a certain gentleman was not our current president, I do now, you know, after some time and reflection, really see it as, you know, what do we need to learn from that to be better? And for me, that's what it is. We need to be better about teaching our folks how to tell their story and connect it to the values of why Democrats are good.
Reconnecting with our roots and our values.
And so if we can do that, and then people feel better about and make it easier and more comfortable for people to go talk to their neighbor. Like I said, it's talking to your neighbor and your coworker and your family member. It's not picking up the phone and the blind dial or the door knock, and you know, where you are most persuasive is to people you know.
Yeah.
Right. And so, you know,
we've gotten to a place partially with the because of the internet, people have found a way to distance themselves, but then also because politics has gotten to be so divisive that people don't want to engage with it because it's going to be difficult and hard. It's not just uncomfortable, it's hard.
Yeah. So. Well, and it's painful in some places. Yeah. And, social media has created an interesting dichotomy, right? On the one hand, it's connected us to a lot more people instantaneously, but it's disconnected us from that personal interaction.
So it
creates a great place. I can sit on my computer at home in front of a screen and say all sorts of stuff, good, bad, or indifferent, but I'm not actually talking to a real person.
And it's also subject to that person's interpretation.
Right.
They can't hear how you're saying
or see it. There's
they
no visual.
Right? Exactly. They don't know if you're yelling or unless it's all bold or capitals.
Right.
Or they don't know if you're being sarcastic.
Right.
They don't know the intonation of what you're
right.
saying.
So it's created an interesting place. I mean, again, it's a great tool for organizing, and it's a great place to feed out information, but it's not a good place to have conversation in terms
real
in-depth conversation. You can have short little conversations, and if you know somebody really well, you can. That's
then you can. Yeah.
Different. But for people you don't know, it's not a place, right?
It becomes more, what I have seen, and certainly with Trump's whole situation, it's more of cult of personality stuff gets built through that, more than anything else. And that's problematic.
Yeah.
And not just because of him, but it's just a problematic approach to politics, I think.
Yeah.
So, So over the years, over the 20 years, what are some of the things that you have done? What are some of the actions or activities, some of the organizing that you have done?
All sorts of things. So I've worked on everything from school board to presidential, and have probably done every role on a campaign there is, and have door knocked in ice storms in Iowa. Project-wise, what I've worked on that are some of more of the interesting. I got to be the state director for Howard Dean in 2004, 2003, 2004 in Minnesota. And that was really one of my more prouder projects, is because that entire effort was volunteer-driven and no paid staff ever in Minnesota. But we were probably one of their most productive states in organizing-wise.
Wow.
And so set up that structure and kind of oversaw that process. And while, unfortunately, he dropped out before we got to caucus in Minnesota, it still reverberates today in terms of the people I see that got involved with the Democratic Party in Minnesota and became leaders there and are still engaged. And that still goes on. My other real fun one was the project in Louisiana, because I went down, you're talking a big oil state, right? And went down to work on the clean energy bill in 2009. So you can imagine trying to talk about clean energy in Louisiana, not the easiest of tasks,
not the
right?
easiest, because actually, for two reasons that actually mesh together. Actually, number one, it's an oil producing state, so therefore they don't want to talk about anything but oil. And number two, pricing for oil and for electricity and fuel is cheaper there as a result of its proximity.
Actually, it's not, which is kind of
No. I've seen
Well, maybe they changed it. When I was there, the big...
I've seen price charts that actually show the further away you get from those oil hubs,
Louisiana,
the more expensive it gets.
It was an interesting... Louisiana has a... and it was a debate when I was there, and maybe they fixed it since then, because again, you're talking almost 10 years ago now. But they were they were having an interesting debate there back then that it was the oil would get bypassed out of Louisiana and then have to come back in.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
It was like a really strange thing.
That would be ridiculous,
But that really the challenge in Louisiana around energy, any sort of energy, is that it is financially driven by oil. Yeah. So, and I yes. learned this actually yeah. talking to the labor, the president of the AFL-CIO. So we, you know, I went in, originally it was about, there was a clean energy bill on the table, and they, it was Al Gore's Alliance for Climate Protection, and they were targeting folks sitting on the energy committee. And so we originally started out as a lobbying effort trying to get one of the congressmen and one of the senators there to vote for sure. this. Yeah. But we quickly discovered healthcare was also going on at the same time, and it was just sucking the air out of everything. So there was like nobody wanted to do anything else because they were really trying to get that passed, right? And so as we were trying to figure out, well, what else should we be doing? And I was making the rounds. I was actually talking to the president of the AFL-CIO, like, how do I get labor on board to help? And he was the one that finally pointed out to me that part of the problem was this. One, when you say clean energy, like, nobody knows what you're talking about, like, because they don't have any scale-wise.
So it's education,
right? So
getting
it was,
people to understand.
So it was like we didn't understand what it was because they don't. And two, it was really understanding down to, like, state, because all state dollars are basically oil dollars. So even your, like, state employees, their paycheck comes out of oil money, right?
Wow.
So it was like this really everything.
So how
I was
do
like,
you really get that?
So yeah, so it was like, okay. So we what we did is we went back in and said, we're going to kind of go back to the beginning and let's talk about what is a clean energy job.
Hi, I'm Tim Apicella. I'm the host of Moving Hawaii Forward, a show dedicated to transportation issues and traffic issues here on Oahu. Join us every other Tuesday at 12 noon, and as we discuss how we try to solve our traffic headaches, not to include just rail, but transit and carpooling and everything in between. So join us every other Tuesday, Moving Hawaii Forward. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nicole Alexander Enos, and I was born 3 weeks ago. Congratulations on being there for me for some of the few weeks of my life. I'm starting a new show, The Millennial Mind, every Wednesday at 2 p.m. for the month of April, where we'll go over some of the reasons why millennials are some of the most anxious and frustrated people at the moment.
Welcome back to ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers. Sorry, we had a quick break there. Okay, so we're talking about the party politics stuff and the differences there. So we were just talking about organizing and how people get involved and engaged and what our new executive director has been doing. So Laura Nevitt is our new executive director for the Democratic Party of Hawaii. So what I want to transition to now for our last 10 minutes here is as the role of executive director here in Hawaii, What do you do? What is your function? What's your job and responsibility? Tell me what you're doing and
what do I do?
What you want to do?
I basically everything, because I'm the only paid staff person with the Democratic Party of Hawaii. Yeah. So I help with communications. I help with data. I work on volunteer recruitment. I work on messaging. I work on relationships with other state parties. The DNC, the ASDC, I sit in on
ASDC.
The Association of Democratic Chairs.
Okay.
And so I'm kind of all things right now, as since there's no other staff people.
Yeah.
So it's, it's, you know, administrative.
So what sorts of things are you trying to accomplish?
Well, right now we're cleaning our data and moving databases, so we're to give some better function for local units to be organizing and organizing tools.
Okay.
So doing that, and also just making sure our voter data, so when we get prepping for election cycle, which, you know, and that working for the candidates, that data is clean.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of going on. Member engagement is a big one. We're right, as you know, we're right in the middle of county convention season. So attending those, making sure members are getting signed up, that they're processed, that asking for their, you know, voluntary membership fees and doing that kind of thing. We have a DEM program, which is the Donate Every Month program.
Which I'm a member of.
Yay. So part of my job is helping raise funds and figuring out how we do that in a multifaceted way. You know,
wow.
Individual donor, small donor.
Your job is everything.
My job is everything. So, and the other thing I'm starting to work on last night and is coming together, which I'm excited about, is this idea of telling stories and actually trying to record our members members talking about why they're a Democrat. And
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, so we're hopefully at the Oahu County Convention, we'll have a camera and we'll be starting to film folks.
That would be great. I think that's excellent.
Yeah, and then, you
what's going to be the end result of that? Where will that go?
We're going to use it. I want to use it for a couple of different things. One is just for social media, right? Is a great, just people telling their stories.
Yeah.
Two, I'd also like to use it for state convention next year as kind of a larger video montage thing for members to see. Sure. And it'll just be an ongoing project. I think it's just one, it goes back to that storytelling and really helping people tell your story, right?
If there's any place to talk story, Hawaii is the place.
This is right. So, let's use that to our advantage and do that thing. So that's those are a couple of things I'm working on besides just day to day, just operational,
making operations happen,
keeping
the door open,
answering the phone. There's literally nobody. I answer the phone. You call the Democratic Party of Hawaii, I most likely will be the one answering the phone and answering people's questions.
I know that every time I show up, you're the one there.
And I staff the office and all sorts of things. So hopefully that will
tell me about as far as one of the things I heard you say is you coordinating with other state organizations.
Yeah.
What are you trying to accomplish, I guess, in that regard?
Most of it is as an ED. There's actually an Association of Democratic Executive Directors. So we all, part of it is just, networking, sharing best practices, getting information. Good place to ask questions is someone who's new to being an executive director at a state party. Mm-hmm. I have lots of just sometimes functional questions of how to do this thing or where to find an answer.
A great resource then.
It's a great resource. So we recently did a forum on the DNC thing and had Chairman Perez and Deputy Chairman Ellison do a video. And
which was spectacular. You were able to pull together.
But that came through those connections and I maintain that's part of my, maintaining those networks
you're maintaining the national connection as well as Tim Vanderveer.
Yes.
He does that as well.
And yes, so a bunch of us do, but they all have other day jobs, and I do not.
And you don't.
Well, this is my day job.
We all have other day jobs.
Exactly. This is my day job.
Which is great. More of us would like that.
I know. It's a fun job. I actually like it. People are, always sort of think you're a little crazy when you do it, but I enjoy it, and it's why I decided I wanted to go do this job. As I'm the Democratic Party is my home, and I'm kind of a party nerd. And
many of us are.
Yeah, well, and I come, Minnesota is, we have conventions and caucuses up the wazoo, right? And so this is how I'm like, I went to Maui last weekend for their convention. And they were all like, oh my God. I'm like, no, I would come do this on my own time, literally, if I wasn't like.
Because it's fun.
Because it's fun. And I like, that's,
Because it's meeting people.
It is. It's
learning
meeting
their stories. It's
and
learning
meeting
what
the members
they're trying to do.
And finding out what's going on in where they're at. Because I don't live there. And it's good. It's a good way to stay in touch with what everybody's doing.
Yeah.
So.
Excellent.
And I like that. So.
All right. So, so now let's transition. We have about 4 minutes left. Let's transition to now.
Yeah.
What is the role of a party when it comes to politics? Any scale. We're talking county level. We're talking school boards. We're talking you name it.
Right.
From that all the way up to president, all levels of government. What is the role of the party?
Well, that's debatable, and I think it means a little something different to everybody else. For me, a state party functions a lot. It's about a place to engage people around the process, right? Election process, just civics process, and being involved in government, because those are all places where decisions affect their lives, right? Every decision at a city council board or a school board or a unit, whatever it is, has a direct impact on people's lives. Most people don't connect that right up.
It's hard to see
especially
when you see the language of all these bills and resolutions, like, I don't know what I'm reading.
Right, exactly.
It takes time to learn how that works.
Right. So I see on the one hand, the parties, that's what they're there for. The other part of it is purely electoral. It's about helping Democrats get elected. But they tie together for me is the reason we want to get Democrats elected is because they bring the value to the table.
Bring the value, the legislative
about
agenda
that,
to achieve
that's making the
principles.
Decisions, right, that are affecting people's lives.
Yeah.
So that is the work we do, and that's and engaging people on that, engaging people to run for office, engaging people to do that work, and helping others who are running for office.
So what's the hardest part, from your perspective? What is the hardest part of getting people engaged, and what's the easiest way that you have seen that have actually gotten people engaged? If you have an answer to that.
The hardest part, I don't know that it's really hard, I think it's just the challenge, is the engagement piece, right? Mm-hmm. But that's mostly, and that's the challenge I enjoy, it's finding how to, what's the connection to the person that's going to pull the trigger for them, because it's different for everybody. Right? And you kind of, we have to get a little bit away from this cookie cutter thingy right? And because it takes more time. It takes more time being out in your community and having conversations with people and finding
out. Which goes back to what you were saying. You have more influence with your neighbors because you know them.
Right? So this
it's
is where.
It's easier to connect.
Right? And this is why we should be doing this work, all that work all year round and not just during an election
cycle. Exactly. Precinct to precinct, all year round,
now,
making sure we're engaging.
The easiest part is, and then the that gets people engaged, is to simply ask. Believe it or not.
You know what? That's actually.
All you have to do is ask, and most people, right? And
we have like 30 seconds left here, I think. But in the world of sales, because in a way politics is sales, in a very specific way, in the world of sales, anybody who's learning how to become a salesman, the hardest thing. Is actually asking.
I know they're fine, but
for them to actually pay for something and buy something from you. So
but
you say the that's easiest, the easiest
but
thing.
It's but it's easy. No, but it's the easy way to get them to do it is you have
just
to ask.
Ask them to come do that.
Right. So. If you don't ask, they're not gonna. It'll never happen.
Okay. Okay. Apparently, we have about 2 minutes.
Okay.
So that's good. Okay. So yeah. Okay. So engaging. So that's the whole point of it is to is sort of like outreach, community outreach based on our values and our principles. Mm-hmm. Talking with people and trying to understand better, trying to build bridges throughout our communities and understand where the differences are, where we disagree, but then still trying to find bridges there.
Yeah.
So that's, and that's what we could be doing. That's what some people are doing. And that's what, as a party, all parties, we'll open that up, all parties probably try or should be doing that same thing.
Well, I think the struggle is every because everyone has a different idea of what a party does or is meant to do, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's also a little bit of a challenge is getting everybody to agree that like this is the thing we want to do, right? And then we're going to move forward on it. And it changes every election cycle. It changes whenever you have change in leadership, because now you have a new leader who now has a different idea of what they want to be doing, and then you know you have to take the time
and,
to kind
and
of
how
shift
they
right.
want
to
do it.
Right,
and
that's just
how do the rules apply?
It's messy.
And
well,
am I
and it's
able
the
to
thing
do?
That people have to say. It's messy. It's not a. It's not a clean. There's never simple answers.
Yeah.
And part of it is also being patient with each other, being willing to listen, and good lines of communication that we're just, it's flowing back and forth so that you hear from me, I hear from you, and we find common ground. And
I think that's the greatest, most important skill that anybody involved in any industry actually needs to have is listening.
Yeah.
Are we listening to each other, not just waiting for our turn to talk?
Right, exactly.
And that's...
Well, you have you ever heard of the step up, step back?
Step up, step...
So,
no.
like, if you're in a big...
I have,
right. So the step up is, you know, if you're someone who if you're someone who doesn't talk a lot, step up. If you're someone who talks a lot, step back.
There
so
you
that
go.
We allow
right.
each
yeah,
other.
Yeah, yeah.
But part of that is just the listening.
It really is. You
it's
need
about
to know how to listen and you need to know how in the cues that go on and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So, okay, we actually have to wrap up now, unfortunately. See how quick this is?
So I know. We'll have to come back for another one, right?
Please. Actually, I want to invite you to come back actually with the with Jack James, the executive director of the Republican Party, and have a nice conversation.
We'll totally
that'll be fun. So, okay, thank you for joining us. This is ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers Politics in Hawaii series. Thank you again to our guest today, Ms. Laura Nevitt, and again, thanks to the entire staff and crew of ThinkTech Hawaii, and we will see you next time.